I was to ask you the question, what is an animal, what would you think of? The most common answer is that animals are highly active, mobile organisms. But that's not true for all animals. Many of them are quite sedentary or sessile. Take this coral, for example.
And then there are bacteria.
Oh, excuse me. Or like the ones in this tissue, for example. Or the 30 million or so microbes that occupy every square inch of your skin. They're actively moving about and feeding and reproducing. Sorry, it's just the truth. And then there are many plants that are even more active than the sessile animals. Take this Venus flytrap, for example. So the definition of an animal doesn't seem as clear-cut as it would on the superficial level.
To understand what animals are, it has to be seen from a taxonomic point of view, or the level of where they sit on the tree of life. So if we look at what organisms are, all of life on Earth, we see that life originated when inorganic material coalesced into organic material that could then be considered cellular form. And the first single-celled organic material were the prokaryotes. Now, prokarya just generally means simple single-celled organisms. And they are grouped into two large domains. The bacteria, being the first organisms to evolve on Earth, would lead to the very large and important domain eubacteria. Archaea are the sister organisms to bacteria. They are also single-celled prokaryote, but they live in hostile environments, such as volcanoes and salt flats and deep-sea thermal vents and things like that. About 3.8 billion years ago, prokaryotes evolved on Earth. They dominated the Earth for almost 2 billion years. Then, about 1.9 billion years ago, these simple single-celled organisms evolved into more complex single-celled organisms that are known as eukaryotes. And the eukaryotes are those that have organelles within. The origin of these organelles is thought to be an endosymbiotic process, where one sort of bacteria-like organism would engulf another, and one would end up living inside the other. There's a lot of evidence for this, that chloroplasts and mitochondria are from the origin of other bacterial life that have just been incorporated into these eukaryotic cells. And the group of organisms that is known as single-celled eukaryotes are the protists. These single-celled eukaryotes, or protists, arose somewhere at around 1.9 billion years ago in the form of algae. At around 1.5 billion years ago, so not long thereafter in the grand scheme of things, the first protozoa evolved. We'll be focusing on protozoa because they're animal-like, and we're very likely the ancestors of animals, including, of course, us. However, they were still unicellular. The evolution of multicellular life came at some point after this, between 1.5 billion and about 700 million years ago. That's when we start to find three main groups of multicellular organisms, which are distinguished by their three modes of nutrition. Plants, which make their own food through photosynthesis, are known as autotrophs. Fungi absorb their food through these strands called hyphae, and they are known as saprophytes. And lastly, animals ingest their food. So there we have the definition of what an animal is. It is essentially a eukaryotic multicellular organism that ingests its food. As a starting point, that definition allows us to see what is an animal and what isn't. And also, from that evolutionary perspective, where they came from. So that's the definition. Now, if I was to ask you to name some animals, what comes to mind? A cat? A dog? Maybe a giraffe? Perhaps a fish or a bird? If those are the kinds of animals you thought of, you're not alone. Humans, generally speaking, tend to think of animals as being what are known as vertebrates. That is, animals that have a backbone. There are about 50,000 species of vertebrates. Yet, the total number of animal species is approximately 1.5 million.
So, if we're thinking about the relative proportion of vertebrates to all other animals, they only represent around 3% of the total number of all animal species. And yet, when we think about animals, we tend to think almost exclusively of vertebrates alone. Why is that? I think that there are some obvious reasons. Humans have an innate tendency to notice things that reflect their image back at them.
And we have the sentiment of kinship. We empathize with their big eyes and their furry or feathered bodies and their close-knit families and their complex social structures. So we recognize ourselves very much in this relatively small group of animals.
So clearly vertebrates are a minority. In fact, if we look at the pie chart of animal diversity, we note that 3/4 of all animal species are arthropods.
That means that there are almost 1 million species of arthropods.
Of those arthropods, most are insects. And of the insects, most are beetles. There are over 350,000 species of beetles in the world, so there are more kinds of beetles than any other kind of animal. J.S. Haldane once quipped that God must have an inordinate fondness for beetles because he made so many of them. But humans don't necessarily share that sentiment. We tend to favor animals that remind us of ourselves. I think that says more about humans than beetles.
After the massive group of arthropods, most of which are insects, and most of those beetles, the next largest group of organisms is mollusks. There are about 100,000 species of mollusks. We're talking about snails and bivalves and clams and that kind of thing. And then the next largest group of organisms after mollusks is the nematodes, little tiny roundworms. And nematodes are probably largely underrepresented because they're so cryptic and so hidden. They're everywhere, inside of things, in the dirt, in the water, in the tissues of just about every plant and animal out there. So it's very likely that when we discover all of the species and manage to properly name them, there will be many, many orders of magnitude more nematodes than of anything else.
So it's important to remember that that number that I was mentioning, approximately 1.5 million animal species, is only the number of animals that have been discovered and/or accurately described. In many instances, previous groups are being separated in two, where we had previously lumped two species together for superficial reasons. This ongoing process of taxonomy will be explored in the next episode. However, now we're just talking about animal diversity. And these major groups that we see in our pie chart here also have a hierarchical structure.
We tend to think of ourselves as important in this vertebrate group of ours among the phylum known as chordates.
The phyla are the large divisions of all animal groups.
You could look at a starfish, for example, and it would be in the phylum Echinodermata. Mosquitoes are arthropods in the insect class of phylum Arthropoda. This ancient-looking creature, the nautilus, is a strange type of mollusk. It is very closely related to the squid and octopus. Strange as it looks, it is an evolutionary success story. It hasn't changed much during the past 500 million years because it didn't need to. Tube worms, such as polychaetes, are annelids, just like earthworms. You'll note that these major groups are structured onto our phylogenetic tree, and we'll explore this later in episode 2. But what you recognize is that the animal cladogram is essentially built off of the tree of life. For example, the origin of life leads to these very simple prokaryotic groups. We have plants and fungi that are off on their own with these various other groups of protists. And then what we see are these simple animals that evolved first, like sponges and jellyfish. And then there's this other group that have evolved sort of heads and thick muscular bodies, including flatworms and mollusks and so on. Those over there are known as ectyzozoa, meaning the ones that shed their external skin or exoskeleton. And then lastly, we'll go to visit the deuterostomes, which include echinoderms and chordates, which are a large group, including the vertebrates. So that's a quick crash course of what is an animal and how do we speak about animals and what they are. When we ask where do animals come from, however, We have to recognize that animals come from lineages, and that the lineages evolve and have adaptive features as a function of interacting with their ecological context. So what does that mean? Well, the evolutionary lineage implies that there are ancestral forms that they've evolved from, and so these involve certain constraints. Darwin described it as subtle changes to pre-existing structures that are a function of new requirements to these changing environments.
A changing environment is the ecological context. It provides the abiotic and biotic factors that will influence the success of an animal at surviving and reproducing, and thus passing on its genes to the next generation. It involves recognizing that each ecological context comes with its own properties, and that these properties can present opportunities, but more often than not, challenges that must be overcome. So when we're talking about the ecological context, we're referring to the types of habitats that are out there. And there are three main kinds of habitats on Earth, the first and foremost being the marine environment.
That's because it's the oldest habitat. It's where life first evolved. The marine environment is characterized by its huge size and its age. The combination of vastness and the massive amount of time it has existed for are important factors for the evolution of life there. So there's been a lot of diversity and a lot of evolution spawned by this marine environment, this original environment in which life first occurred, then evolved. One of the features of this marine environment is its high density, which provides buoyancy for organisms. Saltwater provides a particular type of buoyancy that enables aquatic animals to easily stay afloat rather than sinking down to the bottom. This may seem like an obvious point or even an irrelevant point, but it's an important distinction to make as we move on to comparing evolution in aquatic environments to those in terrestrial environments, which are not nearly as supportive, and where gravity is a much more important factor. The environmental temperature in the oceans is relatively stable. It is buffered against any changes that may be occurring outside of that marine environment, such as in the air. The temperature of the ocean does not dramatically change on an annual or even a seasonal basis. That's important for the creatures who live in it, because there's a consistent environmental stability in terms of temperature. Then there's the osmotic homeostasis, which is the maintenance of water and salts inside and outside of the body and regulated with respect to features of the environment. So with respect to water and salts, salt water is largely isotonic or osmotically neutral for most animals. This means that the concentration of salts in the water is more or less the same as in the animals that live in that water. For example, seawater is about 5% salt, and so is our blood. So there's no problem for osmosis or diffusion in terms of gaining or losing water and salts. And that's another stable aspect of the marine environment. One last limitation in aquatic environments is oxygen. The concentration of oxygen in air is 20 times that of the oxygen levels in water. So this is a really limiting feature with respect to the potential for energetic or muscular activity or any sort of activities requiring endurance based on respiration. Because cellular respiration requires oxygen. So what that means is that seas and oceans are not environments that are very conducive to high levels of activity for animals. Unless, of course, those animals have some means by which to evolve adaptations that enable a very good, strong oxygen transfer from the water to their bodies. As we see in certain cases, like in the gills of fish, which are certainly able to move quickly when they want to. So the next most important environment is the freshwater habitat. In evolutionary terms, this is a more recent environment because the plants and animals that colonized it did so in more recent evolutionary times. Now, this is important to think about in terms of features that are relatively new on the evolutionary timescale. When we think about the osmotic gradient, for example, there's typically osmotic stress for animals in freshwater, because generally speaking, they are hypertonic to that water. That is, the animals will have a larger concentration of salts in their body than in the fresh water surrounding them, and will therefore tend to take on water, or they may lose their salts to the environment. So for animals living in this freshwater environment, there needs to be some homeostatic regulating mechanism to be able to maintain their water and salt balance. In contrast to the marine environment, the temperatures in freshwater environments are not nearly as stable. They're not buffered against fluctuations in the temperature that occur seasonally. In freshwater environments, this is mostly because they're not as vast or as deep, and so the environment is much more susceptible to changes in air temperature and climatic conditions on a seasonal basis. So this is very important if you're an organism living in a stream outside of Ottawa. Or in the Midwest deserts, where seasonal changes will have massive implications, with the huge variability in temperature, precipitation, and the seasonal weather on their environment. Those can both be extremely hostile environments at certain times of the year, and therefore adaptations are required in order for those animals to survive there. Another feature of the freshwater environment is that it's full of microhabitats. Because it's not so deep or as wide as the ocean, it's full of all these varied habitats available for animals to use. For example, the benthic zone, that is, the area at the bottom of a body of water, including the sediment layer. It could be amid emergent aquatic vegetation, those plants that grow in waters near the shores of lakes and rivers. Or on walls, cliffs, rocks, which are a big contrast to the marine environments, which are essentially huge expanses of open water only. These microhabitats allow for niche development and evolutionary adaptations where certain organisms can be specialists in these freshwater habitats. Much more so than in a marine environment. Still, just as with other water environments, the low concentration of oxygen is a limiting factor. So just as with animals in an ocean habitat, if an animal is going to be active at a high level, it needs to evolve adaptations that favor good oxygen transfer. Lastly, the terrestrial environment is one of the more recent habitats to have been colonized by animals. The most prominent feature of the terrestrial environment is that, well, as obvious as it may sound, it's very dry compared to aquatic environments. And you are heavy on the land because air doesn't provide you with any buoyancy. It may seem somewhat redundant or even silly to point out that air is dry compared to water, but that's one of the key differences for organisms that leave the aquatic habitat in order to live in a terrestrial environment. They have to adapt to that dryness, and of course, the consequences on desiccation of their tissues, of their skin, the eyes, the respiratory surfaces, of reproductive units, gametes, we're talking sperm and eggs, and the developing embryos. All of those are susceptible to drying out if animals don't develop adaptations to be able to live in a terrestrial environment. So the next big difference between aquatic and terrestrial habitats is, of course, gravity. Water has buoyancy. Air, on the other hand, does not. So gravity is suddenly an issue in a terrestrial environment, and therefore animals need to evolve support structures that will fight against gravity. That's an important feature of living on the land. Of course, in contrast to aquatic environments, oxygen is abundant in air, so animals that live on land have much greater access to oxygen for respiration. Which means that terrestrial animals can, in principle, be much more active because they're not limited by access to oxygen. However, even though air provides more oxygen than water, it does not provide a buffer against temperature the way a large body of water does. So the environment fluctuates seasonally, particularly in temperate climate zones. As we well know, the difference between summer and winter in a northern temperate environment can be quite dramatic. It can be a hostile environment at some times of the year, particularly in winter. Animals need to avoid that environment altogether by hibernating or hiding or migrating away. Or they need adaptations that will allow them to survive, such as fur coats, or thermoregulatory systems that keep them warm. So when we're talking about animals evolving to their habitats, they're evolving in order to satisfy requirements. Now, the requirements for animals are the same as for most other organisms. They need food for metabolism. They need water to remain hydrated. And oxygen for respiration. They need to be able to interact with the world through the detection of environmental stimuli. They need to move around, at least at some point in their life cycle, to meet other mates so that they can complete that life cycle and in order to migrate to different habitats.
Animals need to maintain homeostasis, which is like a balance or an equilibrium in the body's systems, like thermoregulatory systems, or osmotic, or nutritional. Animals need to be able to get rid of metabolic and digestive wastes, the toxic byproducts of the breakdown of proteins into amino acids that lead to ammonia. And ammonia is toxic to animal tissues, so it needs to be gotten rid of or converted into something that doesn't poison them.
And of course, very importantly, completing the life cycle through reproduction. So all animals need to do all these things at some point in their life cycle. And their ability to do one or the other will certainly be impacted by what environment they are in and what evolutionary baggage they're carrying, which either presents opportunities or constraints. The solutions can be seen as adaptations or means by which to accomplish these needs. Respiration is a solution to needing oxygen. Circulation may be a solution to homeostasis, to distributing nutrients, to getting rid of metabolic waste. Locomotion may be one of these means by which to displace and to engage in reproduction.
And so we can see these solutions as animal adaptations that allow them to most effectively do their thing in the ecological and evolutionary context. And the process that governs most of these solutions is known as diffusion. Diffusion is the movement of substances from areas of high concentration to areas of low concentration. And if we're talking about animals meeting their needs for homeostasis or nutrition, for example, we're talking about the movements of respiratory gases and nutritional substances and waste products that they need to get rid of.
Diffusion is governed by Fick's law, and it's a physical law that tells you about how diffusion works. It was created by Adolf Fick, a 19th century German physician who also had a background in math and physics, and who spent a lot of time dissecting cadavers. Anyway, according to this formula, diffusion varies as a function of the surface area, meaning that the greater the surface area, the more diffusion can happen across that membrane.
It varies as a function of the difference in concentration between area A and area B. So if there's a really big difference in concentrations, that will promote a fast rate of diffusion until the concentrations reach an equilibrium and then diffusion stops. So it really is the concentration gradient and the size of the surface area that drive this. But what impedes diffusion is the distance that it needs to travel. So the further it needs to go across a membrane, the slower or the less effective diffusion will be. So you see how animals can modify these parameters through evolutionary adaptations that allow them to maximize diffusion.
Say, for example, animals in water that need to get oxygen diffused from the water into their blood. We could refer to the fish gills as a means by which to show how a couple of parameters of Fick's law can be modified in order to maximize diffusion. So the first way is by increasing the surface area. Each of the gills is covered by highly folded filaments, and this folding increases the amount of surface area for the same given volume. So therefore, there's more surface across which oxygen can diffuse. The second one is that there's this countercurrent flow mechanism, where the flow of the blood is going, in fact, in the opposite direction of the flow of the water. Now, this means that oxygen-poor blood is always in contact with oxygen-rich water, and this really promotes a high rate of diffusion. Why? Because it's maintaining that high gradient of concentration between the levels of oxygen in the water and the low levels of oxygen in the blood, and therefore really facilitating a massively effective rate of diffusion. So that's an adaptation that favors diffusion by manipulating some of these parameters of Fick's law. I'm talking about surface ventilation here, because that's also what's happening. The gills are being ventilated by the water.
So that's what I'm doing right now. I'm ventilating my lungs by bringing the fresh air in and expelling the old air out. It's essentially the same thing, but I look a lot sillier than the fish when I'm doing it. So what I was doing there was I was really just trying to maintain a high concentration gradient in the levels of oxygen between my lungs and the blood in order to promote a fast rate of diffusion. Another feature of animals meeting their needs through diffusion is that certain parameters of Fick's law will change for animals of different sizes. Most notably, larger animals will see a shift in the surface area to volume ratio.
So as an object of the same shape changes size, the ratio of surface area to volume changes in the sense that small organisms have a high surface area for the given amount of volume, and large organisms have a lot of volume with less relative amount of surface area. What that means is that diffusion will be a challenge for larger animals because there's more volume for the given amount of surface area. Now, if there were no adaptations, if larger animals were not capable of getting their requirements because of diffusion being challenged, they just simply could not exist. But they do exist. And that's because there are adaptations that modify the surface-to-volume ratio in order to favor diffusion for larger animals as well, and to allow them to exist in the first place. So things like distribution ducts, we're talking about little systems that will carry things into the inside so that the air and oxygen and gas and nutrients don't have to diffuse all the way by themselves passively. They'll be taken there actively by conduits, either in circulatory systems or respiratory systems, for example. Another way that Fick's law is modified is by folding surfaces and bifurcating pathways. And every time we do that, we increase the amount of surface area for the same given volume. So you can see that these are modifications of Fick's law on the properties that limit diffusion in order to allow organisms to diffuse where they wouldn't be able to exist at these larger sizes if they didn't have these adaptations that were favoring diffusion in the first place. So these are some of the ways that animals adapt. But where do animals come from? To understand our place on the family tree of life, we need to answer that question. Before the late 1600s, we really had no concept of there being anything other than organisms like animals and plants. Essentially, nothing other than what we could see with the naked eye. There were animals and there were plants that we knew they existed, but things like mushrooms, for example, were considered plants. And as far as anybody knew, things like bacteria just simply didn't exist. That is, until one day in the Netherlands in the late 1600s. When an amateur scientist named Antony van Leeuwenhoek built his own microscope and took a peek at a drop of pond water. In it, he noticed all these little things scurrying around. They were invisible to the naked eye, but through the microscope they were plain to see. And to van Leeuwenhoek, they seemed just like tiny animals, so he called them animalcules.
Fascinating! I observed certain animalcules. Within whole bodies, I saw so quick a motion as to exceed belief. They were about the size of a large grain of sand, and their bodies being transparent, that the internal motion could plainly be seen. Among other things, I saw in the body of one of these animalcules a bright and round corpuscule, placed near the head, and in which a very wonderful swift motion was to be seen, consisting of an alternate extension and contraction. This particle I concluded to be the heart.
Most of what Antony van Leeuwenhoek was looking at were protozoa, a type of protists meaning unicellular eukaryotic organisms. To him, the microscopic life forms in like the ones living in this pond water, seem to behave very much like animals. We're seeing these single-celled organisms move around and interact with the environment. They ingest their food as well. They seem to have somewhat directed behaviors. They're active, using cilia to swim around. There are other smaller protozoa. It's basically going around and gleaning and feeding on bacteria. And so I think that van Leeuwenhoek's description of animalcules as being tiny little animals is quite apropos. Because protozoa, like the ones in this pond water, are likely to be the ancestors of animals, including us. They look and behave very much like animals do, in the sense that they move around, they explore their world and interact with other organisms. They seek out and ingest their food and interact via sensory mechanisms and defensive behaviors. Except the difference here is that they're unicellular. And so that betrays the definition of an animal as a eukaryotic multicellular organism that ingests her food. Here we have a eukaryotic single-celled organism that ingests food. So it's thought that at some point, maybe about a billion years ago, that some of these protists evolved from single-celled individuals to multicelled colonial organisms. Now, the difference between a colonial organism and a multicellular organism is that a colony is made up of a bunch of individuals that are sort of facultative cooperators, if you will. Like this algae. They're benefiting from each other mutually, but it's not a required or obligate relationship. They could just as easily live apart, whereas a multicellular organism like you or me or Frida here, by definition, those cells are obligate partners in that they can't survive on their own. So if we look at a coanoflagellate, which is a type of colonial protozoan, it lives in these colonies on the stem where it draws water via the action of flagella, which are beating, and these food particles get stuck on the collar as they get drawn in the water, and then sent down the main body here for ingestion and then digestion in that main cell body. And if we look at these coanoflagellate colonies as the ancestors of all animals, it really makes sense when we see the most primitive animals of all, the sponges. They are essentially a multicellular aggregate of the specialized feeding cells, which lo and behold, look very much like the ancestral form that we've just seen in those coanoflagellates. So basically, the inside of a sponge is made up of all those derived coanoflagellate cells, known as coanocytes, where they're all beating their little flagella. The flagella are drawing water through pores in the body wall of the sponge into the main body of the sponge, where those food particles are then absorbed by these coanocytes and then distributed throughout the rest of the organism. And essentially, that is the hypothesis for the origin of animals. Having evolved out of the single-celled protozoa, or little animalcules, to one of the 1.5 million species of animals that inhabit our world.